go, guys. Wrapping out 2022. This is episode 36 for the year. It's the most episodes Noob Spearo Podcast has released in a single year since the start 8 years ago. Now, more than 200 episodes brought to you by patron legends who support the show on an episode-by-episode basis, as well as all of our major partners, particularly Adreno and Neptonics. Massive thanks to those guys. This is our last episode of the year, guys, so I got Adam Stern back for a round three chat. We get into all sorts of freediving weirdness here. And then it's catch up with the Spearo Kids in New Zealand. It's Max and Ben and their dad, Don. And we get to hear all about what's been happening in their spearfishing journey. I hope you really enjoyed today's episode. If you're here for the first time, though, the Noob Spearo Podcast is interviews with spearfishing experts, authorities, and characters from around the world. Today, it's a couple of repeat guests. I hope you really enjoy it. Last episode of 2022. Let's get into it. I can't wait to get into today's episode, brought to you with proud partner, adreno.com.au. The Noob Spearo Podcast has been partnering with adreno.com.au for more than 100 episodes, and these guys are awesome. They have huge spearfishing megastores all over the country. You can shop online or in store. Use the code NoobSpearo whenever you spend more than $200, and you will automatically save $20. That's right. Use the code NoobSpearo online or in store when you spend more than $200 and save $20. I love these guys. I remember the first time I brought a spear gun at adreno.com.au down at the Woolloongabba store, and Adreno have been a huge part of the excitement that I have about spearfishing. Check them out at adreno.com.au. Use the code NoobSpearo to save. Neptonics was founded in 1996, making trigger mechs in a barn in the Santa Cruz Mountains. Solid gear that works was their founding principle, and it still rings true today in every pull of a Neptonics trigger, in every snap of a Neptonics band, and in every whiz of a Neptonics spear gun reel, singing with the power of another big fish. We had a great deal. You can use the code NOOB10 to save 10% off anything and everything at Neptonics.com. It's solid gear that works, equipment you can rely on. Save 10% off any order at Neptonics.com when you use the code NOOB10. G'day, Noob Spearo community. We're back with Adam Stern, the most popular man on the podcast. I think both of the episodes I've done with him are well up there in the top 10. It's fantastic to have your energy back. Adam, I've got a list of questions for you. We haven't got super a lot amount of time, but welcome back to the show, buddy.
Mate, thank you for having me. Such a pleasure.
It's always good to chat with you.
Yeah, I have fun. I have fun with our off camera chats too.
Yeah, they're all fun. And you're a busy man though, so you're harder to catch up with these days. It's good to be able to reach out with you and jack up an interview at fairly short notice.
Short notice actually works better these days than planning, because every now and again you're like, shit, I got some time, and you're like, I'll do something.
Yeah, 100%.
Whereas every time if you actually look at the schedule, it's like there's no time ever.
Nah, you've just got to make stuff happen, eh? Like, it's just like, I'll move that and we'll do that and hopefully it'll work.
Just got to make people unhappy. You know what I mean?
Learning to say no. Like, you just have to. Otherwise, you don't get anything done.
How many years does it take to learn how to actually say no? Because it took me forever.
And I'm still shit at it. Like, I always just want to please everyone and do everything and get everything done. And sooner or later, you have to go, this person gets priority, this person gets priority. I'm sorry, I like you, but you don't get priority. Like, otherwise, like, you're just burning yourself and your family and everything else. So I get it.
Yep.
100%. And on that note, I picked some incredibly difficult and, hairy questions to pick your brain on. So hopefully they're not too bad. Spearfishing, effects on physiology, specifically brain and personality. What have you done much reading research into this area? Because there's this speculation in the spearing world that some of the guys that dive deep and dive hard and they've been doing it for a while, it starts to affect their personality and can have all sorts of quirky effects on a person. What do you think?
So obviously there's nothing concrete on this, right? There's just speculation.
Yeah,
and I think that for the most part, what you see in let's call them like deep spearos, right? Now, deep spearos are very much a niche in spearfishing, right? Mm. It's like the extreme end of the spectrum. And what you see in any extreme end of the spectrum, in anything, is people finding this thing that they excel at, or they learn to excel at, and they throw themselves into a community of people that are also excelling at. And because you can only spear deep with a team, right? You can spear deep on your own, but I don't actually know anyone that really does it. But everyone that I know that spears deep, things like that, you know, there's like a team of them. Mm. And so you find yourself in this tiny little niche community. And as you dive, pun intended, deeper and deeper and deeper into that community, you find yourself disconnecting with the rest of the bloody world. And it's the same with freediving, you know what I mean? Like, there was a time when, honestly, I just couldn't relate to people very well who weren't competitive freedivers. I'd be like, well, what do we have in common? Like, you don't understand anything about my life. Like, all I do is swim up and down a rope. What could you possibly comprehend about my life?
I hear what you're saying. So it's like, and there's almost another aspect to it. Like, it's like, because this niche group of people may share a unique dynamic in terms of the way they interface with the world around them, it may not be it might be correlation rather than causation as well, because you're dealing with a cultural aspect to it, and you're dealing with outliers anyway, really, in their own right.
Definitely. I do think there is a causation factor as well. I do think that diving for long periods of time, or let's say when diving and spearing make up a very large portion of your life, I do think that the lessons of diving and the lessons of spearing permeate the rest of your life and permeate your personality, definitely. Yeah.
You're just looking at a person like, I was chatting with Tim McDonald and Bryson Sheehy this morning, and I almost feel like they, you know, like you get into this competitive mindset and you're looking at a person and you're like, yeah, you're worth 100 points and then 10 points for every kilo. You know, totally.
Competitive people are a very specific breed.
Yeah.
And being a competitive person and spending the time to try to understand myself, like, man, the chips on the shoulders. Do you know what I mean? Like, so much of it is trying to validate yourself externally in life, right? Like, you're trying to validate yourself by succeeding in one random, you know, aspect.
Yeah, sometimes that can be a big part of it for sure. Some of it are just that you've got the other group that are just obsessed, and they, you know, they use competition to almost as a thing for themselves. But yeah, it would be interesting examining your own motivations. But most of the people like Bryson and Tim, they're examining themselves, I think, all the time as well. They're very self-reflective, I think, to be able to compete at those levels. Like, they have had a real good look at themselves and the world around them and what they do. So very thoughtful people. And freediving's the same with the elite freedivers, or are they all accountants?
Very much. No, very much, very much. Yeah. I mean, I think, like, going back to what we're saying about, like, the core, like, you know, freediving and everything, or diving, spearing, permeating the rest of your life, like most of the main lessons with these things are just, like, things like patience, things like allowing things to happen in their time rather than muscling through things or pushing through things. Mm. I think from my observation, I think the same thing exists in spearfishing as well. I think the lessons are just as valuable, and I think all of these lessons are possibly even more prominent in hunting. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you run after a fish, it runs away. You wait for it to come to you, it comes to you. Like, all these kinds of things.
Have you read much on the physiological research and stuff that that people have done on deep divers and deep diving? Are there things that you can remember about what happens? I mean, I remember when they started to strap devices to freedivers and swimming pools and stuff, they started to learn about what was happening. Like, that's how we learned about blood shift and some of this other stuff.
Yeah, totally. I mean, like, I suppose you've got two kind of categories, right? Like, you've got what you do describe as long-term adaptations and then short-term adaptations. And like a long-term adaptation is something that like, okay, your body is now changed for the long term.
Yep.
And then your short-term adaptations are things that change on the dive itself. Mm. And there's huge changes happen to the body through just like, you know, long exposure to diving and short exposure to diving. But obviously the cool thing is that the more you dive and the more you train, the stronger your short-term adaptation is going to become. So the more your body will change and move through a series of changes on each dive and each breath hold.
I reckon what I should do with you is create a list of questions to ask a brain specialist to talk about some of the adaptations that could possibly be happening at a physiological level. Because, like, I briefly studied psychology, and the entry-level papers that you kind of do are all about the mechanics of the brain rather than all of the other stuff, the environmental changes. You know, there's the, you know, and so learning about how vulnerable some of our systems are and what the environment can actually do to induce changes, it would be pretty interesting. I think I need to have another chat with you and just write down some good questions to ask.
Yeah, 100%.
Because, like, I really like the way you went in and you put yourself in that big machine, and then you looked at all and you broke down some of the ideas about equalizing. And it was in the light of day, because everyone has the stuff going on inside them. Everyone was kind of guessing. And then what's that machine called that you jumped in and did?
Well, it's just an MRI machine, but it's an MRI machine that was fast enough to take video.
Because most real
of those
time.
Machines can only just take like one image for every like however many seconds, but we got access to one that could like take an actual video, which was really cool.
Yeah, that's sick. And you tried out multiple different equalizing techniques under this MRI and then sort of broke down some of the orthodoxy surrounding it.
That's exactly right. Because we never had a clear image of how these things were going inside. We were just looking from the outside and going, oh yeah, that's what I reckon. And then all of a sudden I hopped in it, and I chucked a whole bunch of other people in it, and we're like, hey, what we reckoned was not right. So
Yeah,
it's really cool. I mean, I think like the awesome thing about like what I'm most particularly like, interested in is when it comes to like the brain and changes and things like that, is that we are playing around with like a really sensitive and like archaic part of the brain, which is the part of the brain which is inducing you to breathe or wanting you to breathe. And I think that playing around with that part of the brain has really immediate and strong impacts on a person. And I would love to look at, for example, what's really going on with people's hormone levels on a breath hold and on a dive, how the central nervous system is being impacted by breath holds and by dives. I think there's so much there that we have no idea about. And I haven't actually read the research, but I was chatting to someone the other day who was talking about how different elements of breath hold actually are able to calm down the nervous system in different ways. Mm. It's like for people who are experiencing anxiety or people who are experiencing things like obsessive compulsive disorder, that breath hold is actually able to like put like a dampener on their central nervous systems. Obviously, like it's super early stages, and it's like research that's happening or research that people want to happen. So it is even researchers speculating, but I just think there's actually so many applications for it in a person's life. And I think that anyone that has ever gone diving will instantly tell you, oh, the second I get in the water, like I feel relaxed, I feel happy, the rest of the world disappears.
Yeah, I know for myself, like I've experienced significant massive levels of anxiety and underlying anxiety at certain times of my life. And I think part of it is just this detachment from our, I don't know if it's a male or a predominantly male thing, but it's like this non-awareness of your actual emotional state and what you're carrying around with you. And breathing is a great way to sit with it and then slowly start to go, oh, that's what's going on. That's there and that's there. And like Tim Caverman talked massively about anxiety and spearfishing and how it had helped him. I think it's another part of it that we don't tend to think about a lot. But I've been reading Breathe by James Nestor, and I've got another breathwork book as well. And one of their massive things is talking about nasal breathing versus mouth breathing, and whether you're sleeping or awake. But a lot of people mouth breathe, and that has dramatic effects on you. So, you know,
I hear people say that a lot of people mouth breathe, but where are these mouth breathers? I don't see anyone doing it.
I don't know. Like, there's certain things. Like, you get this. I was chatting with this guy at the Bull Sharks the other night, and he was talking about how he's had a lot of the stuff cauterized in his nose, and it's opened up his breathing, his nasal breathing. And I think a lot of people just got this inflammation around that back end of their nose, and it's just they sort of, you know, they breathe like that. And I think I'm guilty of it at times too. So it does tend to, I don't know. I don't know if people are being overly analytical with it or not, but.
Well, you know, sometimes you know, sometimes I feel like marketing is all about creating a problem.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, I see so many bloody people, like, you know, like I go for a scroll on my social media, and there's some bloke sitting on a beach going, you know, like, everybody is breathing with their mouths and it's not right, man. Like, you've got to breathe with your nose. I'm like, who? Show me a person breathing with their mouth. Yeah. I can't see anyone walking around with their mouth open. But I'm just not looking in the right place.
one of these books, like, James Nestor ran this experiment with this other guy who's a journalist, and they taped their nose shut so that they could only breathe through their mouth for 3 days. And they did a full panel, like blood work before and after, and there was a marked difference. So there is something to it. But I hear what you're saying. It's like, I think there's always this skew, like this percentile skew. When you tend to do heavy cardio, you notice yourself breathing through your mouth. It's more gasping for me, though, to be honest.
Well, that's when you hit that point, right? You hit the point where you can handle everything. You're breathing through your nose, and then you're like, oh shit, shit's getting real now, and you start going,
yeah. Well, mine tends to be like a. I start to sound like a train. Yeah, but people know it when I run past them. That's for sure. If I'm running, so. What are you doing to main? Are you like, now you're a family man, you're busy all the time, you're working on the farm. What is your day in, day out sort of just maintaining a good level of fitness for freediving and spearfishing?
So, okay, one of the really cool things with me these days is that if I want to maintain like a base level of breath holding fitness for spearing and for everything that I do, I don't actually have to do anything because there's so much long-term adaptation in my body. The second I go on the water, it's like, bang, everything just works. I do have to remain fit so I don't develop my dad bod too much.
Yeah.
So that's just like, I just do like some like calisthenics out on my deck every morning. Because I live about maybe half an hour from the nearest gym. So there's no like going down the gym anymore. You know, I carry a lot of rocks on the farm. Yep. I carry a lot of fencing around on the farm, lots of timber logs.
Yep.
We just had, I got about 15 years worth of firewood that I've got to move from one bloody area to the woodshed.
Yeah.
So physical work, but otherwise I do try to slide in a workout every day in the mornings usually. But as for actually, dive fitness, I'm really finding I don't have to maintain it now. Obviously I'm not competing this year, and I've just got to wait for the kids to get a little bit older before I start like dragging them around the world to be like, come watch daddy dive. It's been hard to like explain jet lag to your one-year-old, you know, and then leave your two kids with your wife while you go off to dive, right? So I don't know if I mentioned this before, but I did decide to take a few years off. But the cool thing about freediving and about diving in general is that age doesn't seem to be a very large impediment to a person getting good. So I'm 34 now, which means I've still got the next 20-odd years to keep training, keep diving, keep improving. So as far as like training for like specialized stuff, that's just out the window. So I'll have to build that foundation up again when I start again.
Yeah, cool. I had a note here talking about spearos giving themselves shallow squeezes. Are you still hearing about it a lot? Is it heaps. Still? Yeah, right.
Okay. Even more.
Oh, no. Is this a YouTube phenomenon? Because a lot of spearos are saying too many of us is like too many of the younger guys, because diving to 20 meters is not actually that difficult, 60 feet, 70 feet, but that is deep enough to start getting squeezes, particularly with awkward posture and hauling fish out of caves and stuff like that. That seems to be a common one. And a lot of people are saying, due to YouTube or social media, people watching experienced people dive down and do these sorts of things, they think they can replicate it. What do you think?
Well, they can replicate it, right? Like, this is the thing, is you can actually replicate that with very little training and very little experience. But you do then more or less put yourself you basically make yourself subject to, well, sorry, not wording this well. You place yourself in a you squeeze. You give yourself a squeeze. You know, you make it likely that you'll squeeze. Because so basically one of the things that happens in your body as you're diving in, it's interesting because I think a lot of freediving education used to teach that the blood shift, right? Like, so, you know, like one of the ways that the lungs handle pressure is that blood plasma moves into the blood vessels in the lungs and engorges those blood vessels so that your lungs can withstand the pressure. And traditionally, like freediving education would talk about that this would happen once a person hit their residual volume, which is the volume that the lungs can't be compressed any further. So you hit that anywhere from like 30 to 40 meters. But the truth is that it happens from the beginning. Like, the second you put your head underwater, you go down 1 meter, and to some small extent, the blood shift is engaging and it's beginning. But the thing about the blood shift is that it's something that it's a part of the dive response, or your mammalian dive response, that takes time to develop. So like, a person who's been diving for a long time will have a stronger blood shift, which means they can go to the same depth as someone else, but they have, let's just say, more cushioning around in their lungs. So, you know, I can dive down to 20 meters and do a fucking backflip and twist around, and there's no issue. But if it's your first time diving down to 20 meters, or if it's your first 10 or 20 or 50 times diving down to 20 meters, you start twisting around, then you can quite easily rupture, especially one of those engorged blood vessels, and you come up and you're coughing up blood. And this is just happening more and more in spearing because, you know, you can take a person who's never dived in their life, and in 2 days or 3 days or whatever, you can get them diving reasonably comfortably down to 20 odd meters or 60 feet. But they don't have the, their bodies aren't capable of maneuvering, possibly even carrying spear guns down to those depths, twisting at those depths, fighting fish at those depths, all the things that you do, like, when you're spearing. Your body just isn't capable of doing it at that depth, and for quite some time usually.
I was going to say, like, it sounds like there's the physiological adaptation side of things, but then there's also the wisdom, and a lot of older spearos that have kind of anti freediving. They say it's an unrelated discipline to spearfishing and it has no place in our community. And sometimes they have valid concerns, and this is one of them, because you can go into a freediving course, you dive down on a rope in a controlled environment under supervision to maybe you do 25 meters and your first or maybe let's just say it's 20 meters on your first course, right? Then some of these guys go out and they try and do that in spearfishing, and they lack that long-term physiological adaptation. They also lack the wisdom to be able to dive and decision-making ability that comes with time, which, you know, the older spearos, their point of that gradual, slow and steady progression, it's, you know, they have got a valid argument there.
Definitely, but this is also why it's super important for any spearo who takes a freediving course to take a freediving course with an instructor who is also a spearo. The worst thing you can do is go and take a freediving course with a freediver who doesn't spear and has no understanding of spearfishing, because then they are very uncorrelated. But I kind of feel like people who say, like, oh, you know, freediving and spearfishing are uncorrelated, it's kind of like saying, well, you know, if you were going hunting, like bow hunting or shooting, you'd be like, well, you know, walking and going hunting are uncorrelated.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly
it's
right.
It's the mode of travel to get there.
And and while that concern is valid, it is partially addressed by having someone that understands spearfishing teach the freediving course. But exactly. also, what is your solution? Like, what training are you offering to the next generation? Like, some of them will take one-on-one, take people out. That's great. It doesn't scale, though.
Right.
It doesn't address the hundreds of people that are coming through and learning, or learning like I did in isolation, blind leading the blind with my poor seasick mate, Mike. You know, where we, you know, I dragged Mike around while he's vomiting, and neither of us knew what we were doing, but we just had a crack. So, yeah, like freediving courses at least teach people how to buddy up, how to rescue, basic physiology, basic techniques. So at least you know what's going on in your body. And then you've just got to learn the wisdom side of it and how it works in a spearfishing context.
Totally. And, you know, it's really not hard to inject what we know in freediving into the spearfishing community. Like we did a thing a year or two ago where I got one person from just about every spearfishing club in New South Wales in Australia, which is a state in Australia, to do like a cost price like program with me where we, you know, got them up to their instructor level and then did an instructor course.
Yeah.
So that information would filter then back through the clubs. And these people, most of them had no intention or interest in teaching, but now we've got a person in every spearfishing club around the state who can be a point of information and a point of training for everyone in their club. So it's really not hard to take the good from freediving and to inject it into the spearfishing community. Mm. I think we just probably need to see more people doing it because, you know, like we just need, like, because we need, effectively, we need to hit every part of the world with this kind of thing.
A lot of experienced spearos have that concern too, where the performance side of freediving makes it through. And you can see it with some spearos, like I'm not having a shot at anyone, but I don't think we need to know your dive time and dive depth.
I hate it, bro. I hate it when someone whacks up, this fish shot at this depth. I'm just like, oh, why? Why do you do this?
Yeah, like if I shot up, I might start doing the opposite. I'm like, I was at 4.2 meters and 27 seconds. You know, because like, who cares? Like, it doesn't really matter. But there's a type of spearo too that really think that, you know, the deeper and longer you're down too, it's like the there's more credibility to what you're doing. It's like, well, I don't know. I'm getting a feed for my friends and family and trying to have fun. That's all the cred I need, I think.
100%, bro. Pretty much everyone I spearfish with dives shallower than me and gets a lot more fish than me. So.
I mean, we've got to have fun with it too, don't we? Like, far out. So many people are so serious.
You know, you can't control that aspect. I think that element is a human thing, and you'll see it everywhere. I think you'll find that stupidity in everything in life, and there's, you know, you've got to let them do their thing, right? The laws of Darwin will prevail in the end. You know?
Yeah, but we don't need any more. Like, the problem with the Darwinian thing is, like, you know, like in spearfishing, it's very real. You know, like people die. You know, the Darwin awards have no place in spearfishing.
Well, yeah, and then it does tend to backfire on the rest of us too. You know what I mean? Like, all of a sudden, we have less people getting into it. It seems more dangerous. It becomes harder to do it. Yeah. Pools won't let you train in their facilities and 100%. Things like that. So, no, it definitely does backfire on all of us. But I think that maybe just as a person who spent most of their adult life trying to, like, educate in freediving, as time has gone on, I've just let go more and more and more of wanting things to be a certain way, of holding other people to expectations I might have for myself. But that might also just be something that's happened as I've had kids and haven't had time to pour as much of myself into it as well. So who knows?
Learn from the best. Adam Stern's courses at freedivingfamily.com are written and presented by some of the world's best freedivers and most experienced instructors. Lessons learned come from years of freediving and teaching at the highest levels and are now condensed and available for everyone. Go to freedivingfamily.com, use the code SPEARO and you get 20% off any course. Now, there's frenzel, advanced frenzel, hands-free equalization. There's mouthful and deep frenzel equalization, even bifinning essentials. Get that finning technique right. It's the 1%ers that make the difference in spearing and allow you to have more time on the bottom, and you feel better even doing it. Go to freedivingfamily.com and use the code Spearo to get 20% off any course. Adam Stern's courses at freedivingfamily.com. I just love a functional and simple spear gun that I can trust when I pull the trigger. Killshot Spear Guns utilize the finest of kiln-dried Burmese teak. Killshot Spear Guns also combine American-made parts and fine craftsmanship to bring you accurate, reliable, and simple spear guns that you can trust, fish after fish. Get $30 off any Killshot Spear Gun at killshotspearguns.com. Yes and amen, Noober. That's $30 off American-made performance spear guns at killshotspearguns.com. I'm really sorry for this terrible accent. Brought to you by Ed Martin at killshotspearguns.com. Are you following at Old Man Blue Dive on Instagram yet? Bert Calder, creator of the Old Man Blue Dive gear, is an absolute legend. They are people that froth on the spearing life and intentionally make super hard wearing and practical gear that will stand the test of time. Visit oldmanblue.com.au and check out a bunch of tough, robust equipment made by people that are just as passionate about spearing as you are. oldmanblue.com.au. I had another question on the Noob Spearo community. I didn't actually poll everyone for questions this time, but this was a question in the community. I feel like you're the right man to address it. He says, hello, this may be a bit of a silly question. I'm not sure. I am wondering if I need to do further breath hold training. I can quite comfortably dive 1 minute 30 to 2 minutes. And from what I've heard on the podcast, it may not be too good to dive longer in terms of safety. I don't really have any spearfishing mentors that I could ask. Is there a benefit to increase my breath hold further if I'm already diving for as long as I would like to? Grateful for any insights.
Yeah, I would say no. I would say there's absolutely no need. If you're diving, if you're doing dives of a minute 30 to 2 minutes, I can't really fathom that there'd be many, many instances or many species that would require you to dive longer. Mm. And you should, if they're like your dive time will actually increase naturally as you just keep diving. But I don't think a person who's at that level should spend their efforts and spend their time trying to train to have a longer bottom time or a longer breath hold. Mm. I think you're where you need to be. You're where everyone wants to be.
Sometimes too, yeah. Everyone just wants to hit that fast forward button. It's like, you know, like I'm a 30-foot diver with a flat out 45-second breath hold. And if that's you, then you've just got to learn to be effective in that window. And yes. Then like you say, like you can learn some technique and stuff, but it'll be a slow and steady progression to improve, I think.
Totally. And this is the issue, is that like the real answer to all these questions, because I get this a lot. I get a lot of people messaging me just saying, hey, like I can hold my breath this long and I can go down this deep. What have I got to do to get better? Or like, I really want to do this. What have I got to do? And like the answer that people that you give people is just never the answer that they want, because they want, oh, you know, pinch your nose, throw some salt over your shoulder, tickle your underarm, and then you'll be able to do it. Whereas it's like, oh, well, you need to spend the next 12 months just slowly training and slowly improving and diving more and exposing yourself to more depth in a slow, controlled way. Ideally, the people around you who know what they're doing and can help guide the process and la-di-da, and they're like, oh, okay, well, thanks.
Is there much going on in the way of research that you know of at the moment? Sorry, back to physiology. I'm a rapid subject change. Is there much that you know of going on in the worlds of research with regards to freediving and freedive training? Because like I've had full blood work done before, and I've told a few people this before, but my mean cell volume was on the low side. My red blood cell count was on the low cell. Low side. Also sometimes anemic with iron and stuff. And I know that when I get in the freedive training in the swimming pool or underwater hockey with CO2 heavy stuff, it has a real massive benefit on me and my blood work. But is there anything you know of where they're actually formalizing some of this research and stuff?
Definitely. So I'll tell you just real quickly that effectively hypoxia will reduce the hemoglobin in your blood.
Okay.
So excessive breath holding to the point though, but very specifically hypoxia, right, will reduce hemoglobin in the blood. Hypercapnia, so being high in CO2, will actually increase hemoglobin production in the blood. So when you get benefits to your blood work, especially from playing underwater hockey, it's because you're doing CO2 heavy dives, breath holds, and training all the time. If you, and this is the interesting thing in competitive freediving, is that if you talk to a diver at the beginning of a season, at the end of the season, at the beginning of a season, it's mostly CO2 work. And then towards the end, it's just like, boom, big hypoxic efforts. And their blood count will always go down towards the end of the season. It's actually really interesting as well, even breathing, like medical oxygen, like 100% O2, will also decrease your hemoglobin levels in the blood. Yeah. And I just mentioned that because a lot of freedivers after their deep dives will breathe O2 as a sort of countermeasure for decompression illness, but that also makes them more anemic. But you can actually increase hemoglobin production through hypercapnic training, through CO2 training.
Okay.
And there's research going on into this all the time. I can't tell you who gave this information or where it came from, but I can tell you that a very high level athlete in a sport completely uncorrelated to freediving decided to get into freediving in a really intense way. They're retired from their previous sport and they're just the kind of person who's just into this kind of thing, right? And they had access to every resource imaginable, like every resource imaginable. And he was like, I want to see what the human body can do with all the drugs that we have. And they explored doping to its fullest extent.
Blood doping.
And this person, sorry?
Blood doping? Like predominantly
everything.
Oh, okay.
Everything. And this person went from like just beginning to doing like 10-minute breath holds where they were moving in a tank, you know, within the space of 9 months. It was astounding, like really phenomenal stuff. Now, once again, there's not like, and there was a whole bunch of research that they were doing, but there's not papers being written in these instances. There's just researchers trying cool shit.
Self-experimenters rather than like clinical double-blind studies and all the rest of it.
That's exactly right. So it's people being like, oh, well, when you do this, this is the result. Not like, oh, we tried this thing and this is the specific thing that happened with the physiology in the body. So we're still not getting those things. But, I don't even know where I was going with that. It was just super interesting.
It's interesting. Like, I think self-experimenting is good. Like, the problem with, the medical system, and I listened to an episode on Joe Rogan, is getting full blood counts done, unless you've got a legit reason, the doctors aren't that keen on it. And because of, like, you know, our insulin response and, you know, not having any sort of consistent parameters around, you know, your fasting time and all this sort of shit, your hydration levels, like, I don't know that the actual efficacy or the utility of the numbers that you get from full blood work. But I mean, I had it done at a set period of time and I'm thinking about going back and doing it. I'm looking at these numbers. They're from 7 years ago. So everything's shifted there. Like, I'm coming up 41 and the human body's really interesting. I think we still don't know jack about big parts of it.
So much.
And so much of it's anecdotal bro science and,
that's right. And it's just like what you said, like, you know, like, for example, you've got this data collected on your own blood levels, but to have anything concrete, you'd have to do it with a whole bunch of people and they'd have to be all different age levels and they'd have to be eating the exact same things at the exact same times. You'd be taking the same blood work the same time and the same hydration levels and this and that, and then balancing it all out. But like, we go and we're like, oh, you know, I got my bloods done. It looked at, because I've had my bloods done at intervals and looked at it and been like, oh fuck, like that doesn't look right. Or that's not what I expected. And who the hell knows if what I thought was going on in my body was going on, or if I just, you know, got my blood done after a certain meal or before a certain meal or whatever. Too many variables. Got to cut the variables out.
Yeah. Do you feel like, you know, O2 and CO2 training, how do you think it correlates to general well-being?
Well, you know, I think that I think there are a lot of health benefits or just general well-being benefits to doing basic breath holding training, right? Some basic CO2 training, basic O2 training. I think there are greater benefits to doing this training dynamic, like as in like doing this training with movement rather than doing it with static, as far as like benefits to the body. In saying that, if you spend the time to just lay in bed and do some breath holding training and some breath holding tables, I think there's actually the most of the benefit is the relationship that you build with your body, the relationship you build with breathing, the relationship you build with your breath, the sensations that you feel in the body, learning how to categorize different sensations in the body, place them in an appropriate sort of category, like, okay, well, that's me having a nose to breathe. Is it making me panic? No. Okay, well, we'll keep going. Oh, well, now the urge to breathe is making me panic. Let's stop. the really involved deep relationship you build with your body is I really think something that for me at least taught me how to have a relationship with the rest of my body. My relationship with breath holding has developed into building a deeper awareness with my entire body. In so many different ways, my muscles, my bloody all feelings and sensations everywhere.
When I was younger, I used to spend a lot of time building a relationship with my body, but it was probably not. It was probably not an appropriate relationship. No,
let's be honest, Trent, you've got a bunch of kids. I'm sure you still have a great relationship with your body.
But you get older, bro, and the libido starts to fade a wee bit. building a relationship with your body, I'm hearing you. I did a lot of Headspace, the app, and that sort of started to become aware of some of the stuff because, I don't know, I was just so disconnected with some of the stuff, like just not even aware of my own underlying emotional state, levels of anxiety, but also like even just having an awareness of pain and how well functioning my body is. And as I'm getting older and sometimes you just don't feel that great. And I think, jeepers, I need to do something about this. So, yeah.
I think it's actually something that's really understated. I know we talk about it a lot these days, but just general mindfulness is I think the effects of mindfulness, like the effects of working out, are not really present until you do it for a while. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you go to the gym and, you know, you go and bench press a little bit, and if you look in the mirror, you can look the same.
Yeah, well, that's true.
After a few months go by of doing it, you're like, wow, there's actually a huge change in my body and a huge benefit to doing this. I think that it's the same thing for mindfulness. I think people don't sit with it long enough. They go and they do a bit of mindfulness or a bit of breathing this or a bit of breathing that, and then after a week they're like, oh, well, I don't feel like a new fucking person, so what am I even doing?
Yeah. Headspace had this, they had this introductory thing. It was like 10 days. And even after 10 days, I started to get an inkling of what I was in for. I think like there's that old premise, it takes 40 days to build a habit too. So yep. I think – yeah, just having the patience to stick with something long enough to actually start to get some of the benefits is underrated.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Mate, awesome to catch up with you, Adam. We are going to have to head off very shortly, but you're always welcome on the podcast, buddy. And I know people have been enjoying some of your online courses. People can check them out at Freediving Family. And we had a Spearo code set up for them too, didn't we?
We did, but you know, maybe I should have told you this. We changed the website to freedivingmanual.com. This is how awesome I am. I didn't even let you know.
I'm still sending people to Freediving Family. It still goes there, I think.
Oops.
Yeah, it still sends people there. I'm going there right now.
No, it's only because it's in your cookies.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So we changed. Freediving Family is our main website where we do all of our freediving courses and la-di-da.
Okay.
And then Freediving Manual is where the actual manual is.
Oh, so if you go to Freediving Family and then you click on online freediving courses, it redirects you.
Yeah. You can still do that.
Okay.
But I might need to send you some new linky things.
Yeah. So freedivingmanual.com and then, here it is. I'm on freedivingmanual.com right now. I'm looking at level 1 freediving, level 2. The ones I think that have got massive things, because so many spearos, actually people in general, like when I started to teach courses, I learned like one in three people actually have, often have equalizing issues.
Yes. So, oh, yes.
There's, you've got frenzel, advanced frenzel, and hands-free equalization. That's a cracker, I think. Give yep. people a good baseline. With the people that are like natural feet down equalizers, what's your best recommendation for DIYers again? Just run me through it quickly, and I can't quite remember.
So pretty much the whole world freediving community has tried to solve this problem, and the only real solution that anyone has ever developed was that the fastest and best way to get a feet first equalizer, to be able to equalize head first, is to actually get them diving feet first. So what I don't know if we have time for me to do the whole explanation of it, but in short, diving feet first will keep this diver's mouth in a position, or in like the correct position. And we need to do it long enough for them to develop like a new muscle memory or a new habit. So ideally it takes between 3 to 5 days of, wow. of diving. It's best if it's consecutive too, of just diving feet first up and down a line. So like when we get these people to come along, we just say, here's your rope. Spend the next few days going up and down this rope feet first. Go as deep as you bloody like. We have people going down like 30, 40, 50 meters feet first.
Wow.
And then after that you flip. And then what you'll notice is that then you'll start to be able to equalize at like shallower angles, and then those angles get steeper and steeper and steeper until you can equalize vertical. But it's pretty much the only way to get around it. Dive feet first. Feet first divers, dive feet first, and then flip.
So the freediving retreats are probably still a good place to do that, because you're getting sustained time in the water, aren't you?
Well, that's why we do them. That's why like we really only offer like freediving courses that run over a week's period of time. That's what Deep Week just sort of like it's one of the reasons why we created that format, was because it's really hard to get someone to come along to a 2-day course and to really have a big impact on their diving. It's usually just enough time to like, here's some new skills, let's have a crack at going deeper, congrats, thanks for coming, see you later.
All right, so for people that want to check out any of Adam's stuff, go to freedivingfamily.com or go to freedivingmanual.com for some of these online courses. You can pump in the code Spearo, S-P-E-A-R-O. I think you get 20% off.
Oh, you sure do.
If you've got equalizing dramas too, or you want to up your game, maybe you're starting to hit a bit deeper, there's a mouthful course there as well. That was where I got to when I started to do my instructors, really starting to get out of that terrible reverse pack Spearo habit of just the groper call or whatever the hell it was I was doing.
But you can reverse pack all the way down to whatever depth too. You know, there's nothing wrong with reverse packing and frenzeling real deep.
It's uncomfortable though. I think, it's not an economical use of your muscles, and it's almost like I get like this anxious feeling when I do it. Whereas when I do the mouth fill, it feels more controlled and organized, and my body's like not panicking as much.
What happens when you're reverse packing deeper and deeper is that it usually causes the person's upper chest and the base of their throat to tense up, which will trigger their anxiety and at the same time make it harder for the air to pass from their lungs into their mouth.
But
if you can address that problem through more relaxation and being aware of it, then that does go away. But definitely that happens.
Awesome, Adam. Great to catch up with you, mate. And thanks for jumping on the podcast again.
Mate, pleasure.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed Adam there. As usual, an absolute character, and despite some audio and tech issues, as per normal, maybe with the Noob Spearo podcast, it was really good to catch up with him. Let's get into it with Max, Ben, and their dad Don, the Spearo Kids NZ. Follow along on Facebook. These guys are super cool. Young frothers, absolutely living the lifestyle. Here we go. Have you got issues with your EQ game? Let's just do a quick little exercise. Put one hand on your chest and do an equalize. Just do it right now. Did your chest move when you equalized? If it did, bad news, friend. You are using Valsalva. You need to go to Ted Hardy's Roadmap to Frenzel course and learn how to frenzel. Now, quite often, if you've come from a scuba background, you will be using Valsalva. This is what you're taught. And when you've got a tank on your back, it's pretty effective. But when you are head down, bum up in the world of freedive spearfishing, you need to learn Frenzel technique. It will get you down and past 30 foot and equalizing with ease. To learn this Frenzel technique, go to noobspearo.com/Ted. Check out the roadmap to Frenzel class. He will get you Frenzel equalizing within a matter of days. Check it out. It's a simple, easy to follow course, noobspearo.com/Ted. Jeremy Gamble from Spearing Magazine, the world's greatest spearfishing publication, says, anytime I hear anyone complaining about the ears, I always say the same thing. Talk to Ted. He's known throughout the industry as the guy that can fix people struggling with clearing issues. There's no one out there that knows more about equalizing and teaching people to equalize than Ted. Check it out again at noobspearo.com/Ted. Noob, it's good news. Did you know that every pair of penetrator fins receives a protective layer of Kevlar 49 multi-axial reinforcement? Do you even know what that means? It means that it prevents chips and cracking. It means you're going to get longevity out of your fins. And that's exactly what you need when you're spending some dollars on some good fins. Visit penetratorfins.com. Get yourself a pair of reinforced super tough fins with beyond industry warranty at penetratorfins.com. Use the code NoobSpearo to save $25 on any pair of penetrator blades. That's right, use the code NoobSpearo to save $25 on any pair of blades at penetratorfins.com. Got a sweet deal for you today, guys. Go to freedivingfamily.com and learn from Adam Stern and a select team of experts on different disciplines. There's Frenzel, advanced Frenzel, enhanced free equalization, mouthful, deep Frenzel equalization, bifinning essentials. These are courses that will give you the 1% that will allow you to improve. Use the code SPEARO to get 20% off any course at freedivingfamily.com. Again, that's the code SPEARO to get 20% off at freedivingfamily.com. Thanks, Adam and team. Love it. We got Max, Ben, and Don on the line. How are you, boys? Are here? I've got to do a catch up with you. You've been on some adventures, I believe.
Yeah.
All right, what's been happening?
Well, I've been doing quite a lot of comps and just quite a bit of spearing since we last talked here.
Yeah, your last time it was Spearo Kids, and you boys are down the South Island, and your voice has changed already. Is that Ben?
Oh, yeah, it is.
All right, cool. So last time I chatted with you, Ben, how old were you? Maybe 10 or 11?
Yeah, I think I was about 12 or 11.
Okay, and how old are you now?
15.
Awesome, mate. My oldest is about your age too. So what sort of mischief have you been getting into in the comps?
Well, last year went up to North Island, got first kingy, which was pretty nice.
Oh, yeah? Whereabouts did you go for a kingy?
Yeah, the Mokes.
Oh, yep. The hen and chicks, the Mokahina Islands.
Yeah.
Man, who'd you get off there with?
Oh, Darren Shields.
Oh, yeah, man. Spoiled.
Yeah, it was mean.
All right. So what happened? Did you have to dive deep, or did they come up to you?
No, there was fish everywhere that day. That was a really good spot.
Yeah.
It was just Tahiru and pink Mau Mau were even up.
Yeah.
And there was just kingfish swirling everywhere, just all around the rock where we're at. Big sharks are swirling around too, young.
Oh, yeah, the bronzies were in there?
Yeah.
Was that your guys' first experience with some active sharks?
Yeah, it was with the big one, yeah.
Wow.
Jeepers. That was quite a good day. How many new species did you get that day, Max?
I don't know. About, six or seven.
Six or seven species, Max. Jeepers, that's a good day out, mate.
Yeah.
He had a good bag of all the different fish to try. It was awesome.
Sick. So kingies were on, and as well as the rest of the North Island species as well. And I hear you guys have got a freezer full of coral trout. Is that right?
Yeah, we do. And Dad went over not so long ago on Darren's reef trip.
Oh, yeah.
And he got a lot of coral trout for us to have. It'll last us quite a wee while.
The boys went over about 2 weeks before I did for a holiday.
Okay.
And they ran amok on a snorkeling trip out of Cairns.
Oh, yep. Did you get some spearing in?
No.
Oh, bugger. What did you?
Yeah, it was a bugger. It was good really good viz. This is the best viz I've ever seen.
Yeah, yeah. And warm water too. I bet you're diving pretty good.
Yeah, it's like bath water.
Yeah, yeah. It's a different experience when you don't have a big, thick wetsuit on and you can see for a while, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ah, well. So what else you guys been up to? Comp diving, you said. Yeah. Have you had a couple of good finishes, or what's the story there?
I think last year I won the South Island champs, the juniors.
Oh, man. Well done. Well done. Is that you, Max?
Yeah.
Yeah? And what is that the under – what's the age group there?
I think under 16.
Oh, yeah? Oh, far out. Did you beat your brother?
Yeah.
The boys are sort of going in as their own team.
Oh, yeah, nice.
So rather than sort of a father-son or a, you know, mother-son or daughter or whatever sort of team, they're sort of hooked up into their own team.
And, oh, nice.
I just sort of follow them around at distance and sort of keep away, otherwise they get yelled at because I'm scaring the fish away.
Maybe drive the boat too if you're allowed.
Yeah. Last time we had a want to tell trick about the float line was a bit short, wasn't it, Ben?
We had quite a short float line, and me and Max were just swimming around. We were kind of sharing one of the guns.
Okay.
And at one point, I had one of the guns, and Max decided it was his turn. And the float line was probably out of the water.
Okay.
At one point, I actually had to grab the float and push it down after Ben.
Oh,
he was going down past 10 metres.
Oh, wow.
So here I am sitting on the float boat trying to get it a wee bit further so he can have a shot at a cod. But, yeah.
Oh, wow. So you boys are diving pretty well then by the sounds of it. How's the teamwork? Because, Ben, I remember when I was younger, I used to play C-grade tennis with my youngest brother, Joash, and we would end up smashing the ball at each other because we were always angry. How about you and Max? Do you guys get angry with each other when you're spearing together, or are you get on pretty well?
If it's just me and Max diving, it can get a wee bit annoying at some stages, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. What, one of you wants to go in one direction, one of you wants to go in another?
Yeah, kind of like that, or it's mainly if you're the person without the gun, you're probably the most annoyed.
Yeah, yeah, yep. But it can be quite rewarding supporting someone as well when they get a fish as well. Have you found that as well?
Yeah, it's good to help, I guess. We're still learning and we help each other for just all the learning experience at the moment, I guess.
Yeah, man. What about you, Max? How's it diving with your big brother? Have you punched him in the water?
Tried to.
It's always good when your brother, I guess, couple of fins in your face as he goes to duck dive.
Yeah.
What did you get at the last chance?
I got butterfish, moki, and kawa as well.
Oh, nice. That's a good bag. Were you happy with it?
I saw almost shot a blanket octopus.
Oh, okay. Oh, wow.
Yeah, one of the rarest creatures in the world. And Max says, comes up to me and he says, "Is that a squid?" As the spear gun pointed at it.
Yeah, yeah.
So we got some good footage of that. There was a lot of people have been watching that video of the blanket octopus and a lot of scientists and stuff.
Yeah, right, eh? What did they say?
Oh, there's only been about three or four people that have seen it.
Yeah, they're a crazy-looking animal, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah. Now, apparently a few years ago, Darren Shields saw one up north.
Yep.
It was getting smashed by a seal, and it actually cut the blanket off as a decoy and then sort of swam away, you know.
Oh, far out. Did you guys watch My Octopus Teacher?
Oh, yeah.
What did you think of that?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, they still taste good, though, don't they, even though you like them? Do you guys eat them?
No, not really, no.
Ah.
I think if you cook them properly, have you got any, you have to get some recipes out of that book of yours. Have they got any octopus ones?
Yeah, there's a few good octopus ones in there in the 99 Spearo Recipes.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a couple.
I think if you cook them right, they'd be perfect.
Yeah, a lot of people say you got to freeze them first, eh? That sort of does a lot of the tenderizing process, and then some people beat them on the rocks or, you know, different things like that. I think freezing it is probably the best go, and then because I think their flesh takes a little while to go through rigor mortis. I don't know if you could dry age octopus and then it would tenderize by itself. That's actually an interesting question. I might have to try that out.
Yeah, the octopus they're quite nice in the water to look at, I guess, but Dad's been attacked by them a couple of times.
Yeah. Once, like, they love bloody taking stuff off you, like equipment and that.
Yeah, they give me cray pots and stuff, but it's a nuisance.
Yeah, true that. I quite like eating them, but again, I was a bit spoilt when I was in Spain. We had them, I think they call them pulpo over there, and the Spanish know how to cook them up. I think all the Mediterranean divers are pretty good with them, the Greeks as well. So we've got to borrow some of their recipes. So what about what's next for you boys? You guys, you're pumping out YouTube videos now. What's the story with that?
We are doing a wee bit of videos. We try to get some footage each dive we do.
Okay. And how's the YouTube journey going? Are you telling stories about your dives? Are you teaching people how you hunt different species, or are you just sharing the excitement? What's your sort of angle with your videos?
Yeah, the YouTube thing is probably the trickiest thing out of all, I think.
Mm.
You know, you've got to get people's interest, and it's hard to judge what people actually want to see sometimes, you know?
Yeah.
Plus, a lot of our diving, the vis is pretty bad, isn't it? So it's clarity.
What editing software are you guys using?
I was using that SVDC one.
Okay.
I don't remember. But there's another one we're using at the moment. I've just put on as a movie pad, which is sort of a bit suited for, but better for beginners, I think.
Okay. Are you doing that on the iPad or something, or on a tablet?
We're just doing that on the computer.
Okay.
I did have that DaVinci Resolve, but seriously complicated, eh?
Takes a while to get your head around, yeah. I was thinking about doing a tutorial because I must have spent about 12 hours watching YouTube videos trying to figure it out, and I think I've got a very good basic understanding of it, but that's all.
I'm
not very good with it. I can just use it, but it can be a bit tricky. But I think if you invest a bit of time and learn how to use one, once you sort of know how to use one of the more advanced editing software, then you can use the other ones as well. You've just kind of got to be able to change a bit. But
With the boys doing most of the diving themselves now.
Yep.
Instead of hopefully it would be a bit easier to actually get some good footage rather than sort of, you know, carry a spear gun at the same time and stuff.
Are you going to film Max? Don.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Have you got yourself a tray? There's a thing that you can make yourself called a tray mount, and it's basically got two handles and then the GoPro kind of mounts in the middle.
I basically made one out of alloy.
Yeah,
and,
nice.
They're perfect. I was using a head-mounted one, but I spend a bit of time with the sort of head out of the water, sort of looking and seeing where everybody is, and you get that sort of water splashing sort of, you know?
Yep,
sloppiness in the water. So,
well, that droplets on the lens too. You can avoid a little bit of that by actually licking the lens too. And then...
Yeah, they tell me that, and going back to my old racing days on motorbikes, that Pledge furniture polish on the lens as well.
Oh, okay.
That works fantastic for anything with water.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
But they've got a couple of comps coming up.
So
what comps have you got coming up next?
South Island Champ.
Okay.
Looking forward to that.
Who are your main competitors in the juniors, boys?
I don't really know them.
Other juniors?
Yeah.
Oh, you don't know who the main guys are?
Yeah, I think one of Dwayne Herbert's boys is. He's pretty good. He's a bit of a force to be reckoned with.
Okay.
And some of the people in the comps are really coming along. Mm. Like the young girl Alex Edwards.
Yeah. I've got to get her on the podcast.
She's gonna throw her in a New Zealand team and look out.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That'll be awesome to see a Kiwi lady in the top of the world rankings. That'll be awesome.
Yeah.
There's a number of good Kiwi girl Spearos. I mean, Kiwi Spearos in general are getting pretty good at competing on the world stage against even the Europeans in their home grounds. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Where do you boys want to go with comps? What do you like about comps, and why do you want to keep doing them?
It's just mainly because you get to meet lots of other Spearos and just be in the water with other Spearos in lots of places with all the different comps. Quite a lot of the places we've been to, we've never dived before, and they're just really nice bits of water to be on.
Nice. Ah, cool. So, Where can people find your guys' YouTube channel? Are you guys still on social media? What's the story there?
Yeah, we're on YouTube and Facebook. Spearo Kids.
Okay.
NZ.
What about your YouTube?
I think that's just the same as well. Spearo Kids NZ.
Yeah.
I'm just having a quick search for it now.
This year, as soon as we got a new motor for the boat.
Yeah.
So we've set that up, and so we can go a little bit further afield and with a bit more reliability. So we'll be really looking forward to some really good missions that we'll put on.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. Nice. So what's the next one? What's the next? What's the next mission you guys got?
Picton, probably.
Okay.
Like Marlborough Sounds or something.
Yeah, we're going up there because. About this time, right in Picton, there's been a few kingfish already seen. So it's Max's turn to have a crack at something, right?
Yeah.
What's on your next hit list there, Max?
Kingfish, probably.
Oh, have you got a kingy yet?
No.
Okay, cool. Well, that's a good goal. And what's Ben? What's your PB weight wise?
I think the Kimmy was 13 kg.
Okay, yeah, nice. So you got room for an upgrade too. But
it wasn't the heaviest kingfish, but I was still pretty happy with it. It was
good. Well, 100% you would.
Upgrade easy.
Yeah, my first one over here in Australia, Brisbane, was a 10 kg, and it took me at least 5 minutes to get the thing up. It was probably the biggest fish I'd ever shot at the time. And, 13, 14 kilo fish, it's a big fish.
Yeah.
They go off too, don't they?
Yeah, they do. They take off, and I got a bit of surprise from just shooting butterfish and going straight to a big kingy like that, just being pulled.
Yeah.
Down the way that I had to adjust my technique and stuff. It makes you
grateful different. For having a float line and a float.
Yeah.
Nice. All right, boys. Well, I've got to head off and have dinner, but it's great to catch up with you guys. And I'll link up a bit of stuff in today's show notes so people can check out Spearo Kids NZ and come check out your guys' YouTube as well. I'll link that up as well in the show notes. So. People can have a look. I can see on your Facebook page you guys have been to Timaru Marine recently, and so it's good to hear. It's good to hear you guys.
Yeah, they did us a real good deal on the outboard, and as did Yamaha. They came to the party with us and gave us a really good deal on the motor. So there'll be a bit of footage with those names on the videos.
Yeah, cool. Your YouTube channel is still pretty hard to find, but it's Spearo Kids, one word, and then NZ. And you guys have got plenty of good videos up there. There's the Coral Sea 2022 trip. I'm guessing that's you, Don. And then there's Picton, New Zealand with the kid, with the boys, Angry Octopus. There's a blanket octopus with that footage you were talking about from earlier. So people can go and check that out. That'd be bloody awesome. But it's good to get.
It wasn't my best day. It wasn't my best moment.
Well, it's good to touch base. It's good to touch base with you guys and see what you're up to. So thanks for giving me a buzz.
No, hopefully, and we'll still have to try and get over there and get a dive with you, because Max is still pretty itching to get a dolphin fish or mahi mahi.
I should have you guys over, and we should just I'll invite you over, and we'll just take you over to Stratty for the weekend. And I'll bring my boys, and you guys can come too. It'd be good fun.
Yeah. No, that'd be good.
All good. Well, I'm going to get yelled at soon for not going to have dinner. So awesome to catch up with you, fellas.
No, it's been bloody great talking to you.
All right.
Yep.
See you, Max. See you, Ben.
See you later.
See you, Don.
All right. See you later, then.
See you, guys. Massive episode today, guys. The last episode of 2022. Thanks, Adam Stern, and thank you to the Spearo Kids NZ for jumping on board with me and helping wrap out 2022. It's been a big year. 36 episodes we've managed to release this year. That's not far off one every week. I'm hoping to do one every week. Let's make it happen. Go to patreon.com/noobspearo. Jump on there. Join more than 50 people helping to power the Noob Spearo podcast on an episode-by-episode basis. Hey, next year we're starting off with an absolute blinder. You're joining me in 3 weeks' time, and we are going to catch up with the survivor of the Port Hedland bull shark attack. We're going to hear his story and some of the amazing insights he's had as a father of three, with a fourth one on the way, and it's going to be cool. So look out. 11th of January, Robbie's episode drops, and we get to talk all about his survival story. Guys, massive 2022. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast, for leaving reviews, for supporting it, however you do so. It's a massive community. I'm super grateful for this job. I'm looking forward to 2023 and a full another year of chatting with legends from all over the planet and just frothing on the spearfishing lifestyle. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. If you're listening after this episode, it probably doesn't mean much to you, but I'm really looking forward to next year. Let's do it. All good. Shrek over and out for 2022. Hey guys, not sure how you stay hydrated out on the boats on those long days out on the water, but staying hydrated is absolutely critical to good equalization and looking after your body, making sure you're not doing those awkward one-legged kicks to the surface when one leg cramps out on you. Go to aqualite.com.au and get yourself a box of sachets. You just simply add them to water. It's less than $1.28 per serve. It's cheaper and healthier than any other sports drinks on the market. Aqualite will make a difference in your spearfishing. Check it out at aqualite.com.au. Use the code NoobSpearo to save 10% on any order. Check it out. Aqualite, made in Western Australia. Kill fish with precision and power, sending shafts from a stable platform with Killshot spear guns. Made in the Florida Keys by Ed Martin, you're buying American-made dependable spear guns. Get $30 off any Killshot spear gun at killshotspearguns.com. Yes and amen, Nooba. That's $30 off American-made performance spear guns at killshotspearguns.com. It says if they're in the shop or on the phone, they can cash in by saying, "Crikey, mate," or "The Noob Spearo podcast sent me." Check them out at killshotspearguns.com, based in the Florida Keys. Today's episode was an absolute banger, and so is our major sponsor, Adreno. Visit them at adreno.com.au. They have a huge range of equipment. You can find it at adreno.com.au. Use the code NoobSpearo at checkout. When you shop online, you can save $20 on every purchase over $200. You can even use that code in-store at some of their huge mega stores Australia-wide. Price beat guarantee on any Australian spearfishing equipment price. Again, visit them at adreno.com.au. Use the code NoobSpearo. Don't know if I'm allowed to say it, but oorah! When I say the words neptonics.com, I automatically want to say it. It is solid gear that works. It's the very best of spearing equipment and components from around the planet. Visit neptonics.com. It's solid gear that works. Visit neptonics.com. Use the code NOOB10 to save 10% off.